C4 and Bryan Nehman.
Listen wherever you are.
FM 97.9 HD2, WBAL.com, and the WBAL radio app.
Last week, the Maryland House of Delegates moved on their legislation. Bryan Nehman, an audience dealing with the issue of juvenile justice and legislation that was announced with Governor Wes Moore, the President of Senate Bill Ferguson, as well as Speaker of the House Adrian Jones. Tonight is supposed to be the final vote on Senate Bill 744 that will deal with the Senate's version of what's happening with our juveniles. Joining us right now is the president of the Maryland State Senate. We'll talk with him about that and some other issues. Good morning, President Ferguson.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning. Great to be with you all.
Let's talk about this, because we do know that in some of the things we had House Delegates, Member Delegate Mike Griffith on last week, President Ferguson, that some things have changed in the House bill. In the Senate bill that you have, one of the things that has been emphasized is getting the state's attorney's office involved with juveniles much earlier, increasing some of the probation time so that juveniles can be monitored a little more, and you still include the issue of auto theft as one of those things that we look at for 10 to 13-year-olds. Is that correct so far?
It is, with a slight change for auto theft, that we have it as a mandatory sins petition for those who are under the age of 13. So we expanded the jurisdiction for juvenile, including firearms and crimes of violence, which had been there, but for firearms was not there. The House has a version that's around a mandatory diversion. We do a mandatory sins petition. Again, this is this very small group of kids between the ages of 10 to 12, where there's a little bit of a difference between the chambers and our approach on auto theft in particular.
So we were wondering last week, because we saw the diversionary program and didn't have a strong definition, if any definition. Can you help us with that? What exactly would that entail?
Yeah, I mean, diversion could be, it really depends on the facts of the case. I mean, it could be restitution. It could be a service provision. It could be requirements on a family to participate in an ongoing program for some period of time. There are lots of different diversion programs that exist, and they're more robust depending on which part of the state you may be in. So that's an issue that we have to kind of deal with in the operations. The big challenge here, and I think this is where it gets really, anything with juvenile law inherently gets more complicated, but this one is where we're kind of in the deep weeds of complication. When a young person, call it an 11-year-old, is doing something illegal, delinquent behavior, they steal a car, they're in possession of a handgun, it is obvious to everyone that something's got to happen. This is not okay. It's got to stop. The challenge is, when you go through the juvenile system, an 11-year-old has to be competent to stand trial. So that means the 11-year-old has to be assessed and determined whether or not they understand what a prosecutor is, what a defense counsel is, what a judge is, you know, the circumstances. I've got an 11-year-old son. You know, he's a relatively smart kid, but the intricacies of the criminal justice system are probably not his forte. And if the child is deemed not to be competent because they don't understand the legal proceedings, then the juvenile services can't provide any service. The child has to be brought to competency, which could take 6 months to a year. And so that's the challenge of having juvenile court jurisdiction for the younger.
But he's competent to know that he steals a car, but he's not competent to understand consequences of that?
Look, you know, this is a legal standard of competency. It is, you know, I think that there are times where 11-year-olds don't have the full grasp of what they are doing. And look, each kid is different. So, I mean, look, there is an assessment of competency. But what we saw before any of the changes were made is that the vast majority of 10 to 12-year-olds that were engaged in the system were deemed not to be competent and were sent home to acquire competency prior to the court having jurisdiction.
And that's, President Ferguson, where I would like to start, when they're sent home, because one of the concerns with the diversionary program, we talked about this last week, is a diversionary program really requires that some adult be responsible for that 11 to 12-year-old to participate in a diversionary program. Right. And in many instances, President Ferguson, there's no assessment of the dysfunction in that home that you're sending them back to.
And so this is where the most important, I mean, if the one thing that results in all of this is a better and more robust SINS process, a child in need of supervision process, this brings in the family. It is a court order. It is a requirement. The standards, the burden of proof is different. It is not a criminal proceeding. It is a process for which the court intervenes and has a court order to provide services for a kid and the family that are not, obviously things are not going well.
Right.
It is not as high quality as I would want it to be right now. But that's part of what this effort is to have the oversight and accountability to improve that SINS process, because other states use it to a great effect. We just have not had it as regularly utilized here in the state of Maryland.
So can you walk us through how you think the probation, the expansion of the probation is going to work, and especially the monitoring situation where, you know, we've been told that sometimes, depending, you know, if it's a holiday weekend or whatever, it can be 5 days before anybody is alerted to the fact that somebody had violated their probation if they have like an ankle bracelet or something like that.
Yeah, look, the ankle bracelets are a whole other ball of wax, and there's a difference between the juvenile ankle bracelets and the adult system pre-detention or pre-trial release program, which is a whole other mess that's opened up this year. When it comes to the biggest thing I think that everybody agrees on is that we don't want to see kids going through this cycle where they're involved in one thing, they get released, they're involved in another thing, it's a new trial. Everyone agrees that that's got to stop. How we stop that is there are different ideas about. I would say where we've landed in the bill is that if there is somebody that's already on probation, if they're not attending their services, then that probation shouldn't end. This to me sort of seems like common sense. It was not necessarily the case with how things were playing out. The other issue is that if a child is on probation or has been released pending a disposition of a case, if that child is involved in another crime, there's got to be an effort to detain that child. There has to be a more serious consequence of bringing someone in. And this is what the Senate version of the bill does, is it kind of puts these common guardrails around the kind of those cases where there's repeat offending happening. You know, the ongoing real-time alerts of the ankle bracelet, this is a bit of a mess. And the juvenile system ankle bracelets are run by a different set of companies than the adult system. Almost none of them have real-time alerts. Mm. And I think this is something that I've tried to dive a little bit more deeply into this past few months.
Right.
There is some serious need for reform around
Absolutely.
The contracts with these companies.
Because you're not helping the child. If you're not doing that, Mr. President, yeah. I'm sorry to interrupt you. If we're not in real time doing this, you are not helping that child, which it is, to understand the consequences of their actions. They assume that there are no consequences if there's no real time monitoring.
It reinforces
of this.
The bad behavior.
That's what I'm saying. It does.
Now, my understanding is that the one that is run by the juvenile service is slightly better. They have a little bit more of a grasp over the ankle monitor. The one that's the pretrial for the adult system is essentially unmonitored, from what I've learned. And, you know, we've had this issue with the amount of money being paid for those who are indigent and don't have the ability to pay for the ankle monitoring process. I mean, this is a basic function of government. We've got to fix this one. And, you know, I think the judiciary has finally come to the table. I appreciate them.
Only after you threatened them.
Well, you know, sometimes...
I just want to say this publicly, Mr. President, I appreciate the fact that $5 million, everybody, was on the table in terms of keeping the monitoring and the home monitoring situation going by the judiciary, and they let the money run out and didn't inform the legislature. And I wish I was down there. I'd have been blasting just like you did. But, Mr. President, that was unconscionable to do that with this program.
Yeah, and look, they do have some points that they weren't in charge of the contract and were pretty frustrated with how it all went out. It was done through public safety, through DCESPS, which bottom line is this thing just had to get fixed. It's going to get fixed. We do have a longer term conversation with figuring out these contracts and making sure that these companies are actually doing their job of monitoring and alerting and that they actually are enhancing public safety.
But the judiciary could have let you know ahead of time. They could have informed you.
That was the conversation we had.
All right.
Yeah.
But I just want to make clear, the technology is there to know right away, right? If someone we just don't have that technology in Maryland.
It exists right now. We've sort of used third party vendors, and there are varying levels of quality amongst the vendors that are being used for the ankle monitoring across the state. And this is a process that we got to standardize it. We got to have a statewide standard of what is expected in each contract. I mean, half of the problem was that there were not invoices being sent in for 6 months, which to me is just this, you know, these
That's
are
basic incredible.
Functions.
That's
that
incredible.
All right. What about the Vincent Schiraldi? And, you know, look, he wrote a book about how he didn't like probation and he didn't like the fact that, you know, was setting kids up in order to go to jail. Do you have confidence that he is the right person to lead an overhaul of a system that is going to expand probation for kids that are going to need it?
Well, I would say, you know, my understanding of the book is that that was about adults. It was not about kids and kids involved in the system. You know, I don't know that the logic is the same. I mean, I think with kids, it's a lot easier to have, or it should be easier to have oversight over where they are every day. I mean, for the vast majority of them, there are not many places that are possible other than school, home, and maybe work, and a program or service provision. So it seems like a much easier system. Look, he is the secretary. Things have got to get better. I think there are some signs of improvement happening, but we need it to be urgent. And he's the governor's appointee to the position. What I care the most about is less who the person is and whether the results are being experienced. And so, I think we're starting to see glimmers of positive, outcomes. There's still, you know, bad cases here and there, but we're not seeing the level as we saw last summer. Hopefully when the weather turns, it doesn't, you know, the message has to be clear to young people. We can't keep seeing this. Breaking the law, delinquent behavior, it can't continue. And there's consequences for it.
We're talking with the president of Maryland State Senate, Bill Ferguson. The vote is scheduled tonight on the version that the Senate is producing. The House passed their version of the juvenile justice reforms they're talking about. So there's going to be a conference committee. Do you feel confident, President Ferguson, that you and the House can come to agreement on the differences?
Without a doubt. We will. We have to, and we will. It'll be, a negotiation. But at the end of the day, we can't keep with the same momentum that we've seen with sort of kids being reinforced that when they do bad things, there's no follow up or consequence for it. And so it's got to change. And we got to hold the adults in the system accountable, too. I mean, I think mm-hmm. that's a big piece of this is there's got to be data making sure that we're actually doing the things that are in part of the law. And, you know, that's where the operational oversight is going to be critical over this year and the role that the legislature will play in continuing to monitor that. And we've got to change the direction of the system.
And why doesn't this kick in until next year? Why January 1st as a start date?
But there's certain pieces that will kick in sooner. That's going to be part of the negotiation in the conference committee as okay. well. We got to make sure that we have the services available across the state. We have them in a lot of parts of the state. We don't necessarily have them in all parts of the state. So there's going to take a little bit of time to come on some of the diversion programming conversations. But at the end of the day, I mean, even if this bill is important, we've got to pass this bill. But we also have laws on the books today. And so the improved system can start happening today if it's executed on every single day with fidelity and with a clear vision and a clear message. And so we are going to provide some extra tools with this bill, mm-hmm. but I don't want to get lost in the fact that whether or not this bill exists, there are still significant resources available today to improve the system.
President Bill Ferguson, we had Governor Wes Moore on and talked with him about his support of this Thrive Academy that has been advanced by the Secretary, Vincent Schiraldi. And actually, Mayor Brandon Scott said he knew some kids that participated in this in Cherry Hill area. But for most people, President Ferguson, putting $14 million now into this thing,
yeah.
they don't even know what this is. Shouldn't it be a better understanding for the taxpayer of what this is that we're putting so much confidence in as a diversionary, element of this?
Yeah, look, there's been some positive results from the Thrive Academy. Not perfect, but better results. And I think, this stuff isn't rocket science. Like when kids are at the deep end of the pool, there's obviously something in the home environment and things that are not going well. And so you got to shift the behavior at the end of the day. You got to have accountability and you got to give the right set of structures and supports to really make it clear that the behavior can't continue.
But there's nothing online to tell me as a taxpayer what this thing. I don't need to know the kids' names. I don't need to know their ages. I can go on ROCA's site and I can see what ROCA does. I can't find out what they do. And I just think from a taxpayer standpoint, President Ferguson, $14 million going into this. What do they do?
Well, part of all of this is transparency in the system and the quality of the services available. So in changing how we're monitoring the system, we are adding a whole component that is about a more transparent service provision process so that we know which services are actually having an impact, which ones are leading to less recidivism. We have great programs existing today. UMBC has a choice program. Mm-hmm. It's been around for 15, 20
years. Mark Shriver, we served together. Mark Shriver really started that. We served together in the House delegates. It's Mark Shriver's program.
It's a phenomenal program. Great results. I mean, they're working with like 300 kids a year, have mm-hmm. almost like above 95% ongoing participation and lack of recidivism. So there are good programs out there. What is not happening is that consistent scaling of the right ones. And so That's what part of this bill has, this transparency part and accountability of the having the juvenile justice monitor be able to look at the quality of programs, have reports about which is working, which is not. You know, I agree. I think we need more information. People should be able to know exactly what's happening.
Yeah, I just ask you one question about Kerwin, yep. And that is, I don't know if you've seen the story from Baltimore County. It sounds like Howard County's got the same thing that's going to happen, maybe even Anne Arundel, where the new budget that came out, it cuts 500 vacant positions. They say no teachers are going to be laid off, but there's going to be this massive reorganization. And we're hearing from teachers that it's going to be pretty significant at the high school level. But the bottom line is that we're getting rid of these positions, and we're going to have larger class sizes as a whole. And it's because they got to figure out ways to cut because the money isn't there. I thought the whole idea was to make the educational system better for kids. And how are we doing that if we're letting go of teacher positions and we're creating bigger class sizes? Do you see this as a possible sign that, you know, that the health of Kerwin isn't so strong?
Look, I think this actually has nothing to do with Kerwin, and from my understanding, you know, there were hundreds of millions, billions of dollars of federal money that came in and was used to support the operations of school systems. What I think happened in a number of places, I know this is the case in Howard County, I believe it's the case in Baltimore County as well, is that these federal limited one-time dollars were used to fund ongoing positions, which is not a good practice if you have one-time money for ongoing expenses. And so with these federal dollars having been spent and not being, you know, renewed, yes, those positions are being cut because the federal dollars are no longer there. That is not if it's being deemed a cut, it's because it was poor financial management on the front end. And you shouldn't be using one-time dollars for ongoing costs. Every single jurisdiction has seen a significant increase in the investment of state dollars that are going towards education. And, you know, one of the things that we've been really mindful of is if you look at the end of the year closeout of school systems, there were hundreds of millions of dollars rolled over in cash from one fiscal year to the next. A lot of money has gone into school systems and they need to spend it well. So I'm glad they're not just spending to spend. But it's very important that we be a bit more transparent about what dollars are being used for what purposes. And look, I get it. I worked for a school system. Superintendents sometimes want to kind of create the crisis to be able to do some things that may be difficult to do in just a regular budgeting process. So I don't know if there's any of that playing out here. The bottom line is we're making significant investments. Kerwin is going to expect things to change and operations to change, but we shouldn't be blaming the blueprint of Kerwin for what is financial management of federal dollars that are now no longer there. And we're one time.
But we shouldn't have bigger class sizes, though,
that's
right?
The issue.
That's what I'm getting
I'd
at.
I'd like to see if it's actually, I'd like to see if it's just paper class size differences or real actual class size differences. Sometimes when these, you know, federally funded grant positions are eliminated, you know, your numerator gets smaller, which makes everything look like it's going to be a bigger class. If they weren't filled, if they weren't real positions, then you're not actually impacting class size in a real tangible way at all. I haven't had a chance to really dive into the details of it, but I'm very skeptical that it's going to have a material impact.
President Ferguson, as always, we know your time is short. We appreciate when you can join us. We'll hopefully talk to you before the end of session. Thank you so much.
Appreciate your time. Thank you, sir.
Absolutely. Appreciate y'all. Take care.
Thank you.